Good morning, church. We want to welcome you to the Northwest region of the Johannesburg Church. My name is Iso, and this is my beautiful wife, Bridget. This morning, we've come to worship the living God. We've come to worship the God of our salvation. Welcome to all those who are joining us online. You are welcome, and everybody else who's here, you're welcome. If you are a visitor this morning, we just want to extend a warm welcome to you also, because you are our honored guest. I'll read the scripture, and my wife will pray for us. Luke chapter 10, verse 20. This is Jesus Christ speaking. He says, "However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." Brothers and sisters, this morning we've got a reason as disciples of Christ to rejoice, because our names are written in heaven. So let's shake off anything that will hinder us this morning and focus on worshiping the God of our salvation. Amen.
Let us pray. Holy Father, Lord of Heaven's armies, good morning, and thank you so much for this privilege of gathering as your family, as your children. Mighty God, what an honor, what a privilege to have been shown your favor, dear God, just to be alive, dear God. Thank you so much that we get to fellowship together, dear God. We get to sing to you. And I pray, mighty God, that our singing, the service, and every aspect of it will be a fragrance offering to you, my God. May it all rise up to you, that you will really be feeling honored and excited that we are representing you, my God. We know you are actually right here in our presence. Help us to even be willing to be undignified as we dance before you, the Lord, our Maker. For indeed, you alone are holy and worthy of all the praise and glory and honor in heaven and on earth, dear God. Thank you so much for just the privilege of being your children and the gift of salvation, that our names are written in the book of life, dear God. Thank you so much for really favoring us. We know it's not our great faith, it's not our good deeds, but it is you being a good God, being a merciful God, being slow to anger and abounding in love. May we honor you with our worship, dear God, focusing and fixing our eyes on you, and may our hearts be good soil for your word to grow as we get challenged and corrected and trained in righteousness, my God. We love you and we praise you in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen.
Amen.
Morning, my brothers and sisters. Welcome. I'm also looking forward to us worshiping and praising God. This song here, as you can see, it actually wants us to go deeper into our hearts. This is not about the lip service. Let's go deeper in worshiping our God. Music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring some goodness of word. I will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song. For a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all
such much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you.
God van vrede, God van lewe, bovenal. God hoor my.
God van gister, God van vandag, God van ewigheid, bovenal. God hoor my.
Hallelujah
in the heaven, hallelujah in the heart.
eeuwig en eeuwig. Oeh, halleluja. Oeh, halleluja. En die hemelstraal van die macht en het heet. En die lewe spreek van die waar.
When it gets dark, I know it's about to get rough. Okay, Makolo, Kumani Zoro.
Makolo.
Oh,
Good morning, church. What a beautiful worship this morning. Wasn't that wonderful? It was absolutely brilliant. Great job, Song Leaders. That was fantastic. This morning, I get the privilege of introducing to you someone who's going to be doing our communion for us. We have an elder all the way from Paris with us today. Yannick Lenoen, he was converted in 1987. He was born in Paris, and then he went to the U.S., to Boston, to be able to do his work, which is software development, and became a disciple in 1987, which is a great year to be baptized, since I was baptized in 1987 as well. So very excited about that. Yannick then has gone back. He's been part of the eldership and the leadership team of the Paris Church for many, many years, and more recently is now the administrator of the Beam Foundation. And yes, we've got excited people about the Beam Foundation over here. And of course, Jacques himself is very excited. If you notice today, Jacques is wearing a collared shirt, and he's got long pants on. That's because his second boss is in town today, okay? So just kidding. But it's wonderful to be able to have Yannick. Can we give Yannick a warm Johannesburg welcome?
So merci beaucoup. So the end of 2022 was a very challenging year for me on many fronts. But I read a book. Actually, I read a book twice in a row. I think that's the first time I've ever done that.
Okay.
And the book helped me to find peace in my relationship with God. And the book title was A Non-Anxious Presence. So, as Justin said, I was born in France, born and raised. I was converted in Boston. But I worked in high tech all of my life. Until the Beam Missions Foundation, which is even more high-tech, I think. But I started in the late 80s, early 90s in artificial intelligence. Yes, back then. Then I moved in the mid-90s into the internet. So I used to go and tell big corporations what the internet is going to change, the way they work, the way they live. And more recently, late 90s, early 2000, I was involved in a company that was making the first smartphones. So I'm saying all this because what I'm going to talk about is how the internet can be the opposite of a non-anxious presence. But I'm not technophobic. I love technology and I believe that technology can bring many things. But I realized reading this book that we can feel a lot of pressure from everything we know. And of course, we're going to go to see what Jesus did with all the knowledge and who he was. So the internet brings a lot of things, but it creates a lot of anxiety. There's always this fear of missing out, not knowing what's happening. There's always the worries of being able to find out everything about any topic. If you learn that someone has a disease, the first thing you go to the internet and you look at all the consequences that could happen to you personally. You read about the consequences of war somewhere, like in Ukraine or anywhere. You read about climate change and what it's going to do to you. You read about violence everywhere. It's terrible. And then personally, I think I sort of an addiction to that. I still fight to get to read my Bible in the morning before I read the news. But I'm still losing many battles on that front. And I realize that the internet is putting on me the tyranny, I don't know if I pronounce this right, of now. You have to be there now. And I realized that the only place to find peace, and you may think, I'm going to say something, a guy that's been a disciple for I don't know how many years, I stopped counting, but find peace in the presence of God is the only way. And that's the non-anxious presence of God that I should be looking for. But only, not only that, but our mission as Christians, as disciples, is to bring a non-anxious presence to our families, to our friends, to our co-workers, to the world around us.
Yeah.
If we can do that, we'll be the light that Jesus wants us to be. And our key passage for this morning is in Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, if you want to open your Bible there, verse 5. You must have the same attitude that that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. And I was reading this passage and I was wondering, what is really the definition of human? Of course, we sort of think we know, and I thought I knew, but I looked on Google, since you can find everything on Google, and it says a human is relating to or characteristic of humankind. Oh, that's very helpful. Yeah. So I go to humankind, and it says human beings considered collectively. Okay. That didn't help either. So I looked a little bit further. So I looked at some Scientific American. That's a little bit more precise, maybe. So it says that research has revealed two distinct human features: complex scenario building and exchanging thoughts with others. So that's the definition: complex scenario building and exchanging thoughts with others. So when I read this, I realized that, yes, in our DNA, God made us to be attracted by complexity, by finding solutions, especially if you're an engineer like me, by being challenged with problems, to build complex scenarios. So I'm definitely human, for sure. But also human is also exchanging thoughts with others, and I'm really enjoying that more and more. I used to enjoy meeting based on the outcome, the decisions made in a meeting. But now I'm starting to enjoy just being with people, exchanging thoughts, and see God's presence, to see also the changes in me. So I'm trying to see God more and more in those meetings. So Jesus was God, and he didn't need Google to know everything. But he became human by letting other humans lead him to death, to the cross. He knew what was in those humans' hearts and minds, like he knows what's in my heart and my mind right now. And he didn't use this knowledge against those humans, like he doesn't use this understanding of what's in my heart against me today. So I think Jesus gave up his divine privilege to let us be humans, and he did it in obedience to God. So my obedience to God is to bring him, God, his presence into this very complex world. And I'll finish with this Psalm 46 in verse 10. And the psalmist talks about God. He says, "Be still, I know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." So our obedience to God is to be still and to know God. And that is the example that Jesus gave us. So as we take the Lord's Supper, that we take, share the bread and the wine, let's think about that. In the non-anxious presence. God Almighty, we pray that you'll be with us so that we can be still and know who you are. God, I pray that you remind us that Jesus knew, he knew everything about us, but he humbled himself before you, but also he humbled himself before us. And as we take this bread and this wine, in remembrance of Jesus, who died for us. In his name we pray.
This concludes the Lord's Supper. Yannick, thank you so much for a wonderful communion message and directing our thoughts. At this point, we're going to take up a contribution. And of course, this is a contribution for the members of the church. The poor contribution goes into the bag directly. And anything you want to give as part of your tithe goes into the envelopes and then into the bag. But I wanted us to think about the scripture that's going to come up on the screen right now. And it talks about, it's an Old Testament proverb, and it talks about honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. And of course, this is consistent throughout the entire Bible, that God is saying that as you honor God, he should be first in our lives and everything. Of course, first in our lives, in our schedule, and our love, and our priority, but also in our finances. That should be the very first thing when we think about at the beginning of every month. When we look at our budget, the very first thing we should do is, what am I going to give to God from this? So often we end up doing it the opposite. We end up, at the end of the month, we say, oops, what's left? And then we say, okay, I'm going to give whatever's left over to God. And that's the very opposite of what the Bible says we should do. It should be a first fruits of our giving. And I wanted to let you guys know just about the Northwest contribution, just so that you are aware. So in the past 2 years, obviously, COVID has hit the contribution in the Joburg Church, and the Soweto region is probably the hardest hit coming through COVID, people losing income, losing jobs. And so over the past year, out of your generosity, we've been able to give for this year and next year nearly R1 million to help support our church in Pretoria, in Soweto. So thank you so much for that contribution. That is tremendous, all right? And I know that our brothers and sisters in Soweto are super appreciative of that. But that has put us under a little bit of pressure as a Northwest region. Also, what's happened is that the interns in the Beam Foundation, they came off the Beam Foundation budget and are now on the Northwest budget. And we love our interns, all right? But that has also added a little bit to our pressure financially. And then to add to that, we haven't been making budget as a church. Okay, so I want to ask you to please think about your contribution, to think about, is it the first line item every month, and for you to start praying and thinking about repledging yourself for this year. Now, what's going to be happening is the Northwest Financial Subcommittee, their faces are going to come up on the screen. These are the guys that oversee our Northwest contribution. So Donnie and Eric on the side there, and Fungai, then Solette, and then Bridget, and of course CJ. They are part of the Northwest Financial Subcommittee, and they oversee the finances. If you have any questions, you can go to them, all right, and ask them, and they'll be coming up in the next couple of weeks to be able to guide us and direct us as a church in our contribution. But let's say a prayer for the contribution right now. Holy Father, we pray that you will help each one of us to make sure that our giving is the first fruits of what we give in our budget. Father, that each of us will examine our hearts, that we will look to you as our Lord, and that we'll make a decision to put you first in everything, including our finances. Help us to be generous as a church. Help us to be able to give, continue to give to Soweto to help, to continue to give to raise more interns into the ministry, and to continue to support the work of the church. Father, we love you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we have a couple of announcements to go through as the bags are passed. First of all, we don't normally announce birthdays, but when there's somebody special turning a special age, we do announce it. And this week, Rita Walker turned 80. Rita, can we ask you to stand? Where are you? There we go, at the back there. Congratulations, that is awesome. All right. Then we also have some special guests visiting from out of town. So first of all, Linnell Bradar from Cape Town, Gilbert from West Africa. Gilbert, where are you? There we go. Okay. And then Heskin and JD have moved back from Australia, back to join us. Now, are they here this morning? Do I see Heskin and JD anywhere? Yes, there we go. Okay, all right. Come on. Welcome back. We knew you would be back. Okay, all right. Amen. All right. Then we're also very excited about our Women's Day that's coming up. The sisters have been working so hard, and they now have over 650 women coming to the Women's Day next week, all right? Amazing. This is going to be an incredible event. And some of the sisters are here to actually practice some of the events. So if I can ask the church, as soon as our last song ends after church, if we can take everybody outside into the courtyard, because the sisters are going to be practicing some of the events on stage. So if we can do that, that would be appreciated. And because International Women's Day is in fact happening this week on March 8th, it'll be International Women's Day where everybody around the world is celebrating. We also have a very special thing in the All Nations app. There is actually a Quiet Time series you can see on the screen here. It's a series of eight Quiet Times that you can have in the All Nations app. So it'll be a special thing about how God loves women so much. Amen. And of course, if you don't know what the All Nations app, here's a little video just to get you up to date with the All Nations app.
Do you want to know what's happening on your mission field? In the All Nations app, it's easy. Scroll down to your Mission Society's page and see what's going on. It's easy to gather lots of information about missions. Have you ever wondered how you can give to missions or where to find out opportunities to go on foreign or domestic mission fields? The All Nations app is for you. Connect with ministries all over the world, thanks to having every ICOC Mission Society represented on the app. With each mission society, you can stay up to date on new adventures and opportunities as they arise and how you can help. The app is loaded with features. The Evangelism Toolkit from Disciples Today is a multimedia Bible study experience, including the first principles Bible studies embedded with custom complimentary videos you can share with anyone you're reaching out to. Tap the Good News tile for good news from sources such as the Beam Missions Foundation, Hope Worldwide, and Kidogo. Interested in what's happening globally? Check out the Announcements tile for global overviews, conference announcements, and more. Are you ready for an adventure? This is your home base to see many of the missions opportunities our fellowship has to offer, and you can apply within the app. Got an idea for the app? Let us know in the Make a Suggestion page. So, are you an empty nester? Download the All Nations app. Are you a campus student? Download the All Nations app. Or are you a single, teen, or married? Download the All Nations app. Wherever you are, whatever language you speak, if you love adventure and seeing God move, this app is for you. The mission field still needs your help. Maybe you can go, maybe you can't. But we can all be inspired, engaged, and in prayer for the brotherhood around the world. Use hashtag AllNationsApp and Instagram to be featured on our social media wall.
Amen. So there is a very simple message there. Download the All Nations app. Okay, how many of you have already downloaded this app? Okay, so about a third of us. All right, so the rest of you, download the All Nations app today, okay, to keep in touch. I now get the privilege of introducing to you our guest speaker for today. So Chris Ogbonnaya and I have been friends for many, many years, and it's a great privilege to have him here with us in Johannesburg. Chris was converted in the church in Lagos. He's been married for 30 years. Both his son and his daughter are disciples in the church in Lagos. And he's led the church in Lagos for many, many years and been the chairman of the Africa family of churches and the West Africa family of churches for longer than I can remember. He's an amazing guy. He's full of faith. He is one of the funniest guy and most fun guy to spend time with. I cannot spend time with Chris without laughing for at least half the time. He's a great friend, and he's our guest speaker today. Can I ask Chris to stand? We can give him a welcome. Amen. All right. The last video before the song leaders will prepare us for our heart is just a Kidogo video giving us an update on our churches in the Ukraine.
Всім привіт. Я хочу поділитися деякими новинами з України. Ми зараз переживаємо дійсно жахливі часи, і я просто хочу сказати вдячність, передати велику вдячність за царство, за людей царства, які допомагають нам. Ми дуже вдячні за всі програми надії, які зараз працюють майже в усіх містах України, де є церква, і допомагають багатьом людям, які зараз в потребі. Це реально спасає багато життів. Ви знаєте, Бог неймовірно працює. Були декілька просто чудових ситуацій з чудом Божим, де Бог рятував наших братів і сестер. В одному місці, коли ракети прилетіли в торговий центр, один брат повинен був вже бути там, але був затриманий перед цим на іншій точці. І він нервувався, чому я затриманий. Коли прилетіли ракети, він зрозумів, що просто Бог зупинив його. Інша сестра в цей момент йшла по вулиці і вирішила перейти в цей торговий центр, щоб щось придбати. І теж було багато машин, і вона вирішила, я піду додому. І коли вона прийшла додому і купила щось в маленькому магазині, був вибух, і навіть вікна вилетіли. І вона зрозуміла, що в цей самий момент вона мала бути там. І просто Бог врятував її. І таких ситуацій постійно багато. Ми славимо Бога, ми дякуємо Богу, що Він дає нам жити, проживати ці часи. Дуже вдячні за вашу підтримку. Я дуже хочу попросити вас. Війна продовжується. Допоможіть нам в молитвах. Допоможіть. Ми тримаємо руки в молитві, але як Мойсей тримав їх, йому підтримував Аарон і Ор. Ми просимо вас, підтримайте нас в молитві. Якщо можете, іншими речами. Ми дуже за це вдячні. Моліться за нас. Моліться за чудо, щоб війна була припинена якимось чудом. Дякую.
And ask the church to stand, and apologies for rocking up on stage early. We were told during the video, they didn't tell us there are two videos. And one last announcement, Tembi is visiting us from the States. If you see her, do give a WhatsApp, like a proper WhatsApp. We're going to sing another song before our brother Chris comes to sing. Just a little talk with Jesus.
Well, it's all right.
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 Don't you know the job?
With Jesus makes it right.
Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Well, I said it's all right.
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 Don't you know the child?
Just a little talk
with Jesus makes it right.
Do you believe it's all right?
It's all right.
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 Don't you know
the child? Just a little talk with
Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah.
Good morning.
Whoa. It's been 17 years since the last time I stepped my feet in this hall.
Wow.
Yeah, 2007. And as I've been trying to come, Jay has been trying to get me.
Yeah.
We've been trying to arrange, but the Home Office, the Home Affairs Office, I hope nobody works there here. The Home Office says not time.
Okay.
And I have no attitudes.
Okay. That's good.
But finally, the Home Affairs Office says it is time. But it is the Lord that moved in their hearts.
Okay.
And it was miraculous because I didn't have it in my plans to be here this year. You know, though we've been planning and trying to get the African D group, like we always love to be in Johannesburg. We try to come and it's not, God has not opened the way for me and my wife to come. And I think that was a time, especially during the World Cup. So it was designed that Africa had to host the World Cup.
Yeah, yeah.
So we said we have to host the African D group where? Yeah. In Johannesburg, South Africa. So we thought we had it all planned out. But the Home Office, the Home Affairs Office. So we went for the interview and they said, where are you going? I said to Johannesburg, and I've been here several times, and I'll talk about my first experience here. In line with some of the things I'm going to be talking about today. And so, you know, I thought, you know, walked in there, you know, I've been a frequent traveler to Johannesburg, so I put in my application, and I was shocked to see the number of people who wanted to come to Joburg because of the World Cup.
Yeah.
Then I said, no, I'm not going because of the World Cup, I'm going to go and strengthen the church there. And they looked at me and said, it is the World Cup or nothing. Do you have a ticket to go to the World Cup? I said, no, I know people there, you know, I've been, they said, no, for now, you wait until after the World Cup. And I'm a soccer player, and I used to be a soccer player, and I loved soccer. So I was thinking, you know, coming here for the African D group, we can use that opportunity. In fact, we were planning to go to one of the games, you know, and we're looking to be close to the World Cup. But they said, no, you wait after the World Cup, you come back. And since then, we've been trying to come back. And they haven't let us in since then. Until finally, my friend Gilbert says, you know, he had come, you know, I think God opened the way for him to come here. He's doing such a fantastic job. It's great to have Gilbert Kimeng walking, just a great man of God and faith. And so he had come. And I was jealous that he had been coming and traveling everywhere, teaching. And so I keep following his podcast and his ministry. But deep down in my heart, I was like, oh, dear, I wish I could come with him. But so this time around, they said, you know, Yannick is another great friend. We call ourselves the Dream Team. And we work together with the Beam Foundation for the Beam Foundation, helping raise our church, you know, mission schools of missions, all over the globe, and we're part of that. And so Yannick called and said, you know, Gilbert is going to Johannesburg, and can you come along with us? I said, okay, let's come along. But deep down in my mind, I had the Home Office, Home Affairs Office in my head. I said, have you sorted that out? They said, Gilbert says, no, you know, it's good, you know, everything will be okay. You apply. And so we got an agent trying to apply. But deep down in my heart, I know the Home Affairs Office, will they allow? And lo and behold, God opened the way. And in just a week or two, or less than that, I looked at a visa come through my email. I didn't have to go to the South African embassy. I didn't have to apply. I just had to send in a document through the email. Thank God for technology. And God opened the way, and here we are. In fact, I got my visa first before Gilbert.
Wow.
Thank you, Home Affairs Office. Maybe they didn't know it was me that was applying. In fact, at one point, Jax was joking, you know, we're joking like, you know, Nigerian ministers, religious people, and applied as religious, as for religion visa. And I was like, they will never give me. And so we're joking, like Gilbert got last year, he came as a corporate guy. So I said, well, God, why didn't you make me corporate at this time? But so Jax was saying, next time I should come as Gilbert's assistant. Assistant corporate guy. So and I was seriously considering it when the visas came through. So Gilbert now had to quickly apply in 2 days to reapply, actually. I thought it wasn't going to be possible. And guess the vehicle that Gilbert came in on? Religion. He came and applied as religion. So my office as a lead evangelist of the church invited Gilbert to a trip he had already planned. So he came as my assistant. That's the humor of all the whole thing. So we were all praying for Gilbert and sending all the paper from the church office, sending him our bank account that had little or no money. But eventually God says, okay, open the door. And Gilbert is here. By the grace of the Lord, he came in. And we all came by the grace. And so we're very, very grateful to be here. I want to thank Jay and Irene for just being such great friends. Thank you so much. Your family, it was great. I think I haven't met, haven't seen your daughter yet, but I mean, seeing Luke, you know, it was great. You know, we never thought we'll ever come back, but God opened the door. So coming into this building, it brought floods of memories of many, many years where Joburg was like the Mecca for those of us in the ministry in Africa. You know, when you come to Joburg, all your problems are solved. Financial, economical, social, spiritual, you know, because the ark of God was sitting in Johannesburg. So we all came, you know, and the first time I had my experience of coming here was in 1995. Do you remember 1995? The whole movement was in Johannesburg. And we came, and I was part of the soccer team that annihilated all our movement, everybody. Brazil, Argentina, we killed them. Both in basketball and soccer. You remember that point, that three-pointer from Eve Florent? We all remember it kept us alive for many, many years. We smoked all of them out. Yeah, they're our brothers. We didn't smoke them out. We just encouraged them. So, but it was great being in that team. It was great. And so we kept coming and kept coming. And so every time we were in Johannesburg, it's always a pleasure. And I thank God I've been opportunity to come here to be in the church in Pretoria. I've been able to go to church in Cape as well. But I haven't been to Durban and Port Elizabeth. And we're thinking one day I'll be able to see all these churches. But, you know, but I'm very thankful to be here. Very thankful. And the things I'm going to be talking about today, I hope it resonates with you. It's all about freedom in Christ. Just a little call to discipleship again for all of us. And I know I want to thank you if you're visiting with us. This is the family of God. We don't have it all perfectly organized and sorted out, but we love God. We love each other. And so I bring you greetings from my leaders, from all the church leaders in West Africa. You know, it was short and sudden. Some of them were like, where are you going? I mean, you didn't plan this. I said, well, the Spirit says now. And so I wasn't able to gather all to get myself together. Even jumping on the plane, we're still trying to sort things out back home. But I'm glad that I bring you greetings from our churches in West Africa. My wife and I started leading that church in 2004. And that is the time you don't want to be given a leadership responsibility, because everybody had an idea of where we're going, and we were all hurting. And if you have been baptized then, and you've been hanging around since 2004 till now, I say thank you for being here. Thank you for holding on. Thank you for all the friends, that those of you that I know that I don't know. It's been a journey since 2004, because in 2003, we know what happened, you know, and how God really, you know, just came to, you know, discipline, chastise, you know, renew us, and many, many other things that we've learned and sifted us. Yeah. But here we are. Many, many years, and we're still standing, you know. And the evidence of that is just this little gray. I have to keep the gray to remind me that I'm aging. You know, some people look at, can you play soccer again? I say, I am a pundist now. I'm a soccer pundist. I sit in my home, I watch, and I direct affairs. Like yesterday, you know, I directed the affairs, the Holy Spirit, and Arsenal smoked them out. So, I'm sorry, I am the one who have this privilege to speak to you, so permit me for these few seconds. Arsenal fans, if you are here, Arsenal, 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 Arsenal. We take them one by one. Are we going to win? I don't know. But what I know is we're going to smoke them out one by one. So if you don't fellowship with me today after church, I can understand. If you are from Chelsea or Man U or that, may God bless you guys. Because we are free, so that's why I'm talking today. I'm free because I'm among brothers, amen. If you want to stone Jay, because he invited me to speak. So before I finish here, let's go to the Bible. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the privilege we have to gather together as brothers, as we break bread, and sisters, as we break bread together, as mothers and fathers, being reminded of Jesus Christ, being reminded of the peace that he has come to give us, being reminded that, God, we can feel safe with you. Father, I beg you that, God, as we open the word again and as I try to just ride on the same things that my brother Yannick had talked about, just the way, God, that we all need to find that peace in Jesus Christ, to remember the price he paid for us, the cost it has to be to have this peace, that today we can break bread, we can celebrate his death, his burial, and his resurrection, and the power that comes from being disciples. Father, please help us. Open our hearts for wherever we are today, that we'll all be encouraged again as we share and as we encourage each other, you know, to remember that Jesus came for freedom. And for this freedom, we will continue to push forward. Thank you for discipleship. Thank you for saving us from ourselves. And Father, when we were on the path of self-destruction, you came and you rescued us. Thank you, God. And today I pray that whatever I share today will be a reminder for all of us that in this family, that we will continue to pursue freedom for us and for everyone. For our friends who are visiting, Father, please open their hearts. I pray that they will fall in love with you and fall in love with your church and your people. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Who are the freest people in the world? Who are the freest people in the world? That's what we want to talk about. The freest people in the world are the people who are freest from the world. Wow. You know, for many, many years, significantly and historically, this country is a full example of freedom. When people talk about freedom, there is no mention of freedom in any quarters that one will not remember Mandela, or one will not remember South Africa, the Rainbow Nation. And this, I stand today to continue to see that as a nation, when we talk about freedom, we are always being mentioned. And so, I ask my South African brothers, are you really free?
Come on.
Are you really free? The nation is free, but are you free in the church? The freest people in the world are those who are free from the world.
Wow. Yeah.
And that's what I want to share today. So, how free are you? How free am I? You know, I was converted over 30 years ago, 1989, Jay is my senior brother in salvation matter. So but I am free, yeah. as he is free. Yeah. And if you were baptized yesterday, you are free as we all are free. So it's not about how old or when. It's just that when we come in contact with that blood in at baptism, when we have confessed our sins and we come into this family, we are free from the world. We are free from our anxieties and our fears and our doubts and everything in between. Because I remember over 30 years ago before I came to know Christ, I thought I was a Christian. I thought I had it all going for me. I lost my dad when I was 14, and for many, many years I never went to church. I was invited to church when I was 24. So for 10 years, I didn't have a father. I didn't have a direction in my life. I grew up in a ghetto, in a place called Ajegunle in Nigeria, in Lagos. That is where all, you know, that's where the poorest part of town. Barely had food to eat once a day. To go to school was challenging to, you know, somebody told me, you know, I know we've started experiencing power outages. Yeah. Yeah. I'm sorry. You know, from where I come from, I'm sorry. If we see light for 1 hour, we celebrate. So may it never get there. Okay, praise Lord. But so we all have generator. So we have to, everybody has to have a generator. If you are selling anything, you just have generators of all size and shapes. For big, for rich, for poor. So if you are a designer of generator, you can come to Lagos and you'll find a market. You know, and so again, we feel things was bad growing up, and there was crime, there's corruption. There's a survival of the fittest. You just got to get out of the ghetto. You got to get good education. You got to be creative. So most of the creative people in Nigeria and Lagos, they call from Ajegunle. The top musicians, the top soccer players, the top artists. In fact, any creative guy, Luke Berger, he has his roots in Ajegunle. Because in Ajegunle, when you are hit, you know, with tough times in life, you get away. You find a way to get free. You find a way. And so if education will give you the freedom, you go after it with all gusto. If it is learning, anything you do, you got to be the best, because it will get you out of poverty, will get you out of squalor. And so I understand what it is to fight for freedom, to even eat. And that's what I'm talking about, to even survive. So becoming a Christian, at 24, I had that mindset, because I had that fear, and it affected me, you know, trusting people. You know, every day I live with fear, you know, wanting to live, wanting to grind, wanting to know that, you know, everything has got to be a fight and a war. You know, as a soccer player, I play in the defense. It naturally came to me, because he fed on my sinful nature. Kick them, bruise them, hack them down. Get them before they get you. That was how I grew up. And so coming into the church, I thank God for the blood of Jesus. Amen. But I came in like that. You know, everything was war. So the natural fit was, you know, man, everything was fine. I said, man, that guy is good for the ministry. He's a go-getter. But there's why I'm getting the go. It wasn't about Jesus. It was about me. You know, it was all about me. And I had to learn that for many years being in the ministry. Learning what true freedom, because I kind of feel like everyone is after me. I got to survive. I got to make it happen. So even though in my lips I say it's about Jesus, but I know it's about my survival. It's about being somebody. It's about making it out of the ghetto, my own spiritual ghetto that I've created in my heart. And so I live in suspense. I live in competition. So when they say, oh, cooperation, yeah, let's cooperate so long as I win, or as long as we win. You know, so it was a battle. And so I had to learn the lessons. You know, so that wasn't how I came to Jesus. I came to Jesus a troubled man. I came to Jesus a confused man. And so being baptized. I remember 24th of October, 1989, I gave myself to God, and God has worked many things for me. And God has helped me to trust, God has helped me to build faith, God has helped me to build security in Him. And it's still a battle that I'm fighting every day because my default mode is always to be afraid. I don't like flying. I don't like flying at all. And so I got to get a job where I have to travel. So while everyone is happy flying in the aeroplane, you know what I'm thinking? My freedom. So I sit in there, and then the announcement I don't like is that the door has been closed. And all cross and all check. You know, that's a word they use, those in the aviation, cross check and boom, boom, boom. And that means the door is closed. And I see everybody happy, joyful, and I'm like, guys, the door just got closed. Nobody, and we close, and then we're going to be flying thousands of feet on the air. And I'm like, what if something happens? What if something goes wrong? So I hate not to be in control. At least if something goes wrong, I can run. If something goes wrong, I can dive. I can fight. I can do whatever. You know, one of the channels I don't like watching is Air Crash Investigation. I don't like that channel. And they show it for 24 hours every day. And I'm like, why? It heightens my anxiety to fly. I said, so in my head, I feel like everything will go wrong. People tell me the safest way to travel is by air. And I said, amen. Me, the safest traveling is by walking. If I can walk anywhere, it is safe for me. Why? Because I can see the danger before it sees me. And I can do what? Run. But when anything happens, and then the pilot says, buckle up. I say, why? I thought this was the safest ride. So why am I buckling up? And they say, oh, by the way, if in the eventuality of something happen, Max will fall off. I say, why? Why is he going to fall off? I say, oh, look behind, under you, there's a floater in case we fall into water. So we can fall into water. So we can crash. Say, yes, you can. So why are we enjoying inside here? Why are we at peace? Why are we drinking wine? You know, they serve wine, they're serving food and all that. So for me, when freedom, it comes at a cost. And I'm like, well, it's not going to come at the cost of my life. Let somebody else pay that price. But I want to be free to defend myself. I want to be free to fight. I want to be free to do this and do that. But God takes away that and say, have freedom in me. He qualified it that the freedom is in Christ. But I've been wired to feel that I will fight for my freedom by what I say, by what I do, by how I react. So I've got to go and grab freedom. But that is not so when you get baptized. The day you've gotten baptized, you are giving everything to God. So I'm in that aircraft and I'm like, well, all my safety is in the hands of this guy, the pilot. So I think, what if he falls asleep? He's drinking wine too. What if he's intoxicated? What if he forgets to press one button? And so I get so anxious. My wonderful time flying is when they say, we're about to land. And I'm like, okay. And then we touch ground. Great. I say, oh, praise the Lord. And they say, how was the flight? It was awesome. The flight was awesome. And all that. And I don't want to tell everybody the stories in between, from takeoff to landing. Even with the landing, this is belt up too. But I can't wait because we're coming down. At least my leg will be on the ground. Say, so God designed man to be on the ground, not to fly. The birds are the ones that are supposed to fly. Why you guys have decided to put me this is to fly, I can't still imagine. But you guys say the freest and safest way is to fly by aeroplane. So if you are like me and you are anxious, welcome to the club. Okay. We all need to have faith. Amen? Amen? Let's have faith in the system and let's fly. So I need a lot of prayers to keep believing that God will take care of me. So I'm saying this to describe my own freedom, how I see freedom, how I see how I was, and how I understand the scripture and how it applies to me, and how, again, it informs and feeds my default mode of how I'm going to see things in the church and see things in my relationship with people and react to things that I read in the Bible and how that feeds in me and how the Spirit is supposed to transform me to a different person and change my personality and change my nature and change my default mode. Because that is what the Spirit is. So here in Galatians chapter 5 verse 1, it says, for freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Freedom, for freedom Christ has set us free. He wants us to be free. He wants us to depend on him, to trust him. Because we live in a world where there are many things who say, hey, over here, money says trust me. Politics says trust me. This, education, knowledge, trust me. I will take you over. I will be with you. And we are going after them. And Jesus said, hey, stop. Turn around. I will give you all the freedom you need. That in this world, you are going to pursue all these things. You're going to be the best you want to be. But in me, you will find freedom. And too often we found that the things that we are following and we're holding on to other than Jesus fails us. They fail us. The seat belts can fail. The oxygen can stop, can fail. No matter what man has created outside Christ, it fails. Government fail. Politics fail. Talk about it from where I'm coming from. We just came off a presidential election. They did everything to say, okay, we've stopped all the manual, let's go technology. And this is where Yannick will have to answer. All the high-tech guys. I mean, election was, you stand, everybody stand, that I used to know, okay, we count. 1, 2, 3, we count. How many? 5. But when they report you, they report 10. And so we start arguing. So we say, okay, no more cheating. Let's go beavers. That is about, technology. I can't still figure that. And we trusted that. And somehow we went to the election last Saturday. And as we're all performing, people went on air. People still hijacked it. People cloned the sites. They went to the guys who designed it, gave him more money, he redesigned another one. So while we are voting, other people were voting. In the internet, technology. So, which results do we believe? The one they want. And so I didn't say the president didn't win, but he has won. And he's our president. Amen. Please don't quote me. He's our president. I will support him. Amen. Nothing that man makes is devoid of corruption. Everything will fail. Everything in this part of the world will fail us. Only in Christ do we have true freedom. So there is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Those who continue to put their faith in Christ. The pastor said, we have received a gift of righteousness from God that depends on faith in Christ. A mind-blowing, glorious truth. And we have to remind the church, even during that period of, campaigning and all that. Guys, you can see how the tension outside is beginning to find its way into the church. And we all get trying to get political. Oh, this one will be this, this one will be that. We trusted on people. They failed. Now who are we going to trust? Oh, is this guy? Is this political party? If they come on, all our problems will be over. In this world, Jesus says we're going to have many troubles. And so sometimes we say that, but we don't understand what that means. Because a good number of us are still in bondage as Christians because politics still has a place in our hearts. The world still plays a big part. It's still occupying a very big but docile, calm place in our place until it is triggered. And so it comes out. So we have to enjoy that true freedom that comes from righteousness. Because that's only is the word of God. My constitution in my country, I don't know which one, how many constitutions we're even following. I'm sorry, but we have one Bible. And it's not confusing.
That's right.
The Bible, if we stay simple, Chris, what are you talking about? Look at all this that going on. Yes, whether it's in the internet, whether it's the generations before us, our generation and generations to come, the metaverse, the universe, anywhere. Yeah, welcome. But the Bible will remain the same. Amen. And so whatever it is, God is proving to us that we've got to know what true freedom is. So how free do you really want to be in this world? How free do you really want to be? How free should our country continue to be? Not a reputation of being free. Not a signboard for freedom. Or a signpost for freedom. Not a history of freedom. But that in here, in this country, now and now in the church, there is true freedom that we all enjoy in Christ Jesus. Amen, church.
Amen.
And I had to preach this to my people because we are troubled souls in the church. We feel many pressures, economic, political, social, during the COVID period. God showed us that he is God. That the true freedom is in him. He shut the whole world down by a virus that nobody could detect. Nobody knew it was coming. Hey, you know, let me blame China. But I believe with all my heart it's from God to tell us that he is in charge. He locked all of us up. We became slaves in our homes. We didn't solicit for it. Because no job, no movement, no airplanes flying, no diplomatic, whatever. Shut down. The most equipped people, the most equipped nations in the world, where everybody wanted to run to, suffered more death than even people who had no medical facility. It was scary. Watching people die in America, in Europe, Africa was going to be toast. Dry toast. Burnt toast. And we were all waiting. No ambulance. No hospital. No medicine. Our people were more confused. And the thing was coming. It was coming. It was rising. Say, it's going to come. We're all dead. People began to prophesy. The end has come. Finally, the end. Everybody, we are going to all die on the streets. People started giving their lives to Jesus. We had the largest number of growth in our church. People were like, can we study the Bible? I give my life. Yeah, no more. Because, you know, when it happened, for 1 week we were home, we're like, this is awesome. Those who had no holidays said, wow, this is great. 2 weeks, wow, this is great. 1 month, when are they going to find a solution? There is no solution. Nobody knows. Well, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, nothing. Then you knew those who were really free. They were just running helter. Churches were closed. Everything was closed. And so people were giving their lives to Christ. Oh, wow, God now, God. We had in 1 year, 66 teenagers got baptized. Yeah. We were like, you know, please. You know, some of us now started doing devos. We have time now for devo. Family devo. Not church devo. Family devo. With all your children looking at you. Something like that, bro. Especially teenagers. They are going nowhere. Some of us learned how to surf the net at home. All the lessons we've been teaching on parenting. They started begging, can we have parenting classes now? Can I have parenting because my kids are going to kill me? They are here everywhere, you know? I can't shake them up because no school, no play, nothing. They are there with you every morning. So repentance on parenting, amen. So everything was ad hoc. Well, no, we will die. You know, we used to have parenting workshop, 40% will come, 60%. Now we're having 110% attendance. Jesus purchased and gave us a life-governing, joy-producing, experiential, and radical free reality. It was a reality. So it wasn't a sermon anymore that the world is nothing. People began to preach it like, this world, it will be destroyed by fire. You say, no, it's not by fire, by virus. And we don't know. So everybody began. So guess what? We started having people turning. So again, praise the Lord. 2 years has gone by. We looked at each other. Oh, we didn't die. Okay, the virus have gone. Jobs have opened. Everything is going, life back to normal. We now, our default mode begin to come in. And right now we're begging, no, I'm on the internet now. He said, no, it's over. Come to church. No. The virus will say, no, the virus is gone. Come out. So we are back now to 3 years after. Bro, can you come to church? No. Can you WhatsApp me? Can we do Zoom? He said, no, we are tired of Zoom. Can we see each other face to face? So now it is a joy each time we meet together. Yeah. But people are crawling out. You understand? You see how circumstances change our reality. Yeah. But in all this, God is still the same. Yeah. God was faithful and consistent. He has set us free indeed to live in a world as long as we are in this world. But God will not change by the circumstances around you. Things are going to happen to you like it has happened to all of us. But God is the same. He wants us to still enjoy that freedom. I had COVID. I thought I was going to die. I repented quickly, confessed my sin. And I said, God, I will die. I said, no, you are not dead yet. Each of my people said, I'm here. Now I wake up, no virus. So where is God? Because every day I woke up. My prayer, my head lay on the knee. Now, my first thing is to check on the news, like what Yannick is saying. Let me know what's happening in the world before I even know what God has to say to me. So I've gone back to re-enslave myself again to the world. It is still that game of freedom. God is telling us, are you really free to be with me? Let us remember that God is there even in the trying moments. The secret to experiencing this freedom all depends on where home really is for us. This world is not our home. Amen. We sang that song during COVID more than ever before. This world is not my home. We saw people who had health, who had wealth, die. But then, you know, the key to living our own life is what made our faithful forebearers free was really who they ultimately believed in, as in Hebrews 11:6, and where they believed he was leading them. For us, it was like, God, just make things better. Just take away the virus. It wasn't about, God, take me home. Bring me home. If it is now, hey, let's do it. As this song we sing, you know, when we say, that Jesus should come. What's that song, you know? Yeah, let me remember. The brother said I was going to sing, right? The brother invited me, said I was going to sing. I told Jay it was a setup. You know, this song we sing about, you know, Jesus coming back. You know, that's, so he will come, you know. So now he will, very soon, yeah, we'll see the. Some people say, not too soon. Some of us said, no, sir, please, can the Lord tarry? Because I want to get married. God, don't come too quickly. Because I want to go to school. God, don't come too quickly. Because I want to do this. I'm going to. So You are subverting our prayer. Why some of us are praying, God, now, now, now. I don't want, other people are praying, God, please, hold on. Don't come. In the same church, we're all praying. So Jesus is now confused. Should he come or shouldn't he come? So I ask you, should Jesus come now? Yes. On this side, should Jesus come now? Yes. Oh, you are free. Should he come now? Yes. What about here? Should he come now? Yes. You see the confusion. This is the unity we have in our church. Hebrews 11, 14, 16 says, for people who speak thus, they make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Yeah, come on. So we are going to heaven. Yes, the older ones are saying amen. Let's go to heaven. All my pains and joints. I don't want visiting hospital all the time. Can we get to heaven now? The young ones are saying, no, I wanna play soccer, man. I wanna play for Man U. Please don't come now. You know? We desire a better country, a heavenly one. And you are not gonna go there by your choice. You can't kill yourself to get there. You gotta wait for your time. Yeah. Though it might be painful and stressful for you, you've gotta wait patiently until God brings you home. Amen. Amen. But we all have gotta have that desire, young or old. These people believed, the Hebrew writer believed that the better country was what they desired so much that they were content to die in faith, not having received these earthly things promised them. But having seen them afar, they greeted them and cherished them in their hearts and longed for it to come. They acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth, strangers in reverent fear. So people, we need to live as people who are free. Brothers and sisters in the congregation here, do everyone here feel free? You are free not to, you know, we are free to no longer live as captives to the world's values and claims and cravings and threats. Since here we have no lasting city, you gotta have convictions about it, that no matter what you have on this side of the earth, it is temporal. One day, we begin without you and we begin without me. And you are gonna take nothing. Naked you came into the world and naked you will depart. In 2020, we buried so many people. I attended more funerals than I ever. And 2 years after, we are acting as if that never happened. How our memories are so short. And yet right now, we are still in conflict with one another. We're still fighting. We're still desirous of worldly things. And we fight and kick and hold on to things that are empty and disappearing. Your position, your title, your responsibility, it will fade. You are free to walk by the Spirit and not to gratify the desires of the flesh. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 to 20. Since where the Spirit of God is, there is what? Freedom. Yeah. Is there freedom in our church? Do you feel it? You are free to not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth. We are moth and rust destroy, and we are thieves breaking and steal. But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven that is indestructible. Jesus preached. We learned that the hard way, because some of us saw people die who had everything around them, money, position, titles. They couldn't help themselves. You are free to be content in whatever situation you find yourself, since you know that your heavenly Father will supply all your needs. Philippians chapter 4, verse 11 and 19. And these are scriptures that we have to ruminate over. You are free to die as a Christian. Since to be Christ, to be, to be with Christ in the heavenly country is far better than anything we know here on this world. If you believe that truly in your heart, what are you fighting for? Why not rather be wrong? Why not let go of conflicts and bitterness and anger and all the things that beat us down in our congregation? If the country that Jesus is promising us is better, why are we trying to build something that is better than that? We can only build what God has given us the strength to do. It is God who is working in his church. And he will defend the church. You are free. The only freedom I have is to love my neighbor and to do good to all. Nobody responds negatively to love. Everybody. So how rich are you in love? As a rainbow nation, are we still divided in color, creed, language, tribe? That was what made the rainbow nation beautiful. Because I think that rainbow nation is in heaven. Where we're neither Greek, nor Jew, nor Gentile. Neither we are nothing colored. That is the country where there is no corruption.
Amen.
Nobody can steal the ballot box. You die, it's finished. You don't need beavers. You don't need lawyers to defend you. Your walk on this earth and God will decide where you spend eternity. Can you love again? Can we fight the real fight for freedom so that everybody in our fellowship will feel loved? If you are visiting with us, I thank you for coming. Let me just say this before I close out. How free do you want to be? You walked in here today, you're not going to find a perfect church, but you're going to find people who are trying to really be free in Christ. And we're going to do our best. And we're going to keep reminding each other that that's what this battle is about. In Acts 2, 36 to 40, during the time this was penned down, the Israelites were under the heavy rule of the Romans. Yes, they followed Jesus for 3.5 years. Yes, they saw all the miracles. Yes, they saw him feeding the 5,000, the 4,000. Yes, these disciples were close and personal with Jesus, but they had other things in mind. Jesus was saying, I'm going to die, and I'm going to go to heaven, and I will prepare a place for you. They rebuked him. What do you mean you will die? You that you are raising someone up. Come on, we're all going to live forever. Jesus says, this world, this is not my kingdom. And they're like, yeah, we understand. Your kingdom will come. We know. Just don't worry. Let them kill you. When you have power, your kingdom will come. And so when Jesus had power, they said, Lord, when are you going to establish that political party that will take us away from Roman rule? Their minds were still like ours. Jesus says, no. The time I do not know. It is not an earthly kingdom, guys. That's what I've been saying. No, Jesus, what are you saying? You mean you're still going to leave us here? With these Romans? With these tax that we're paying? With these corrupt people? You're going to leave us here? Take us. We say, no, I will come for you. You stay here. But when? He says, the time, the date, I do not know. But you will walk the same way I did. Yeah, we saw you being beaten. We saw you being rejected. Yes, I promise you that where I'm going to give you, I will build a mansion. I will do this for you. But before then, you will walk like I walked. You will go through it. What do you mean? A lot of them did not understand. And so even as they preached and I began to resonate with them, here is what they said. This one, Peter himself, having to understand, he says, let all house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made both Lord and Christ, made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom he crucified. So he began to understand that this is not about a political thing anymore. Now when they heard this, they were caught to their hearts and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? This is intense. And he said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children, for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. So those who received this word were baptized, and there were added about 3,000 that day. So what is my thing? thing to you. Jesus must be your Lord and Messiah. Yeah. You must give yourself. For those of us who have given yourself, you need to give yourself again. Is Jesus really your Lord and Messiah? If you are going to be here 20 years after now, Jesus will still be your Lord and Messiah. Yeah. No matter when, he's still Lord and Master for Jay and I. We are not the oldest here, by the way. There are those who may have been baptized on Pentecost Day who are still here, but it's okay. He is still your Lord and Master, amen? You believe me, amen? He's still the Lord. It's not only Lord for those coming through the door. It is Lord for all of us who are still inside. And so is it still, because we've got to exemplify that. We need to keep repenting and being baptized. You know, you've got to be baptized, and we have been baptized. And once we are baptized, what? We live in sin no more. And of course, the scripture says it's replete with that. The reason here is that God is able to forgive you your sins. No matter how you came through, like all of us came, we came with a baggage of sin. We need to learn to lay it in the feet of Jesus. He can forgive us our sins if we turn ourselves in. And then he will give us the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's a promise. He says it's in the Bible. So for us here today, brothers and sisters, in conclusion, Christ has brought you freedom, brought me freedom. When he saved me from my lies, my immorality, my default mode of fear and doubt, my corrupt ways. And for the last 30 years of my Christian life, I've been battling deep-seated sin in my own life, being transformed by this Holy Spirit, and I'm still a work in progress. So if you are visiting, we're in this battle together. We want to run it together. Yeah. But until we get to the finish line, we've got to stay with Jesus. Yeah. His words will never change, no matter how old you get. Don't stay here for too long hoping that there will be a new edition. There will not be a new improved edition in the Bible. It will be the same old truth. And the Bible says not one word will depart from that word without fulfillment. We've got to live as people who are free. Let Jesus be the Lord and Messiah in your life. If you are still in sin, repent. And give your life to him. Let's continue to live. If you are coming in here, yeah, we want to study the Bible with you. We want to look at the scriptures. We want to look at your life. And if it doesn't conform, change, please. Whatever it takes, don't settle for anything less than the full freedom God has called for you. Seek with all your heart to get right with God. Both for the old, the young, all of us need to watch ourselves. Make time to study the Bible with someone who has invited you here today, if you haven't already done so. And if you're a disciple here, can we go back to our relationship where we can show each other the word? I beg you, let us continue to fight for that freedom. It is not over. And so I end by saying, for those who are freest in the world are those who are freest from the world. I pray that the world has not encroached into your life. And I hope you are not living by the patterns of this world. Let us free ourselves so that freedom will continue to hold sway. We love you. Thank you. Pray for us as we pray for you. God bless. Amen.
Chris, another round of applause. Thank you so much, Chris, for your lesson. I think we should arrange an international comedy night, and I think Chris will be the headliner. You have had my attention the entire service. What I appreciate when you shared your fears when flying, I saw that as an analogy as well. You were in this plane, your focus was on landing. Our focus should be on landing, and that landing is, our focus is in Christ. While we're on this earth is our airplane.
That's right.
With all this stresses around us, stresses in the plane, you hear the things going, they're tasting this, and you see the people drinking wine and being happy. I think this is what we're experiencing on earth. With all this mess around us, people have set in. We aren't from this place. We have a focus, and that focus is in God. Thank you very much, Chris. Glory Church. For those who feel they need to go down to get the kids, they may do so.
Yeah.
Just to understand this song, in continuing with what Chris said, victory belongs to Jesus. We are introducing the song, so we are going to just do the chorus, and then we're going to do the vamp at the end. So please remember, victory belongs to Jesus. Thank you.
Victory belongs to him. belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to Him. Oh, oh, oh. Victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to Him. Oh, 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 oh. Victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to Him.
Victory belongs to Jesus.